from coast to coast and around the world, it's time to praise the Lord. Praise the Lord covers the major Christian events in America and across the world, from the heart of Europe. The tip of Africa. From the centers of Asia. To Central and South America. To the world's largest prayer and praise gathering. Joining us from Southern California are founder and president of Rhema Bible Training Center in Tulsa, Oklahoma, Reverend Kenneth E. Hagan. Senior pastor of Rhema Bible Church in Tulsa, Oklahoma, Reverend Kenneth Hagan Jr. Pastor and founder of Word of Life Christian Center in Darrell, Louisiana, Dr. Leroy Thompson Sr. Ministering in music, country western gospel singer and recording artist, Vern Jackson. Ready to take your calls. Prayer partners from around America.
Praise the Lord, let every nation rejoice. Praise the Lord with one mighty voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise.
Now your host, founder and president of the Trinity Broadcasting Network, Paul Crow!
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Hello, everybody. Coast to coast, shore to shore, border to border, and around the world, it is time to...
Praise the Lord!
I have a little amen corner here tonight, and I coaxed my little sweetheart into coming here tonight. Wasn't quite sure till the last minute, but the Lord moved upon your sweetheart, and you are here.
Well, you know what? There has been so many things to do the last month. Getting ready for the 25th. Oh, you know, Jesus. The 25th anniversary of TBN, we've been doing a book. We're doing a book. We're putting together video 25 years. And I literally have been working just really, really hard. So I just thought, well, maybe my duty should be to get all of that ready. We've got concerts with Carmen. We've got every TBN partner that you've ever loved coming to the 25th anniversary. But I knew it was Dad Hagen, and I just couldn't not come for him.
It has been far too long since we've had our Papa Hagen here. And Hagen, his precious son, Ken Jr., is here tonight as well. And a disciple of Brother Hagen, Brother Leroy Thompson Sr. from Darrow, Louisiana, is here tonight. We'll have a wonderful, wonderful, you know, we're going to do a little refresher course on the word of faith.
Yes. And the authority of the believer. On the way over here, I was just thinking, I'm going to ask Dad Hagen, how did he come up with that in the very beginning? I guess he didn't. I guess God did, but the revelation might be very interesting.
Get ready to read me a little scripture here that many people think Brother Hagen wrote. But he will give proper credit to the Holy Spirit, I'm sure, just a little bit here, Mark 11, 23 and 24. But let me give you a tiny bit of news. I just flew in hours ago from Milan, Italy. We'd been up in London, England with Benny Hinn, had a glorious service. You know, we think of the British people as kind of being stodgy and conservative and reserved, and all, man, they hooped and hollered and carried on just as bad as we did. And we had a wonderful time and some awesome miracles of healing. In fact, if we have time in just a little bit, I've got a little surprise for you. They had a surprise for me there at that great service there in London, England. Then Benny and I went down to Milan to help Chuck and Nora Hall in their fourth Praise-a-thon. And we had a debt-burning service in Milan, Italy. And the people over there got excited, and Italy is very close to being totally self-supporting over
out
there.
Out of debt.
Yes. It's wonderful. And I got to see, dear friends, the Shroud of Turin. Honey, there were people on the floor weeping. There were people in prayer. There were people literally just weeping, weeping, weeping. There was a spirit. Let me tell you. The scientists say, no, you can't prove that it's the real shot, but they can't prove it's not either. And it was that same feeling, honey, when we first stepped into that empty tomb. You can't prove that that's the empty tomb, but your spirit says, this is it. And the devil tried to destroy that shroud again, twice, a terrible fire in the church. But they allowed us to do something that the other networks were not allowed to do. They let us bring our television camera in. And tomorrow night, Benny Hinn will be here. Benny was with me. And we taped a little interview there, and we got to take your camera in to tape the real Shroud of Turin with the image of the face of Jesus Christ on it. It will be awesome tomorrow night as well. So what a great night we're going to have. Let's have Vern Jackson come and join us. Let's have a little scripture reading, a word of prayer, and we got to get down to business quick because Pompa Hagen has to get up early in the morning and teach Bible school, and he has to get out of here on an airplane by about 9 o'clock or so. So we've got to get going. Hello, Vern Jackson.
How are you, sir? Well, good to be here again.
Nice to have you back. And you will dedicate this first song to our precious Papa Hagen, will you not?
I certainly will. This song just fits him.
It's his song.
It's his song.
And is entitled,
"The Longer I Serve Him, the Sweeter He Grows."
All right, this is for you, Papa Hagen. We'll have it for you in just a moment. But first of all, a little word from the Word.
Well, I'm going to read from Dad Hagen 11, 22, and 23. If you only have faith in God, this is the absolute truth. You can say to this Mount of Olives, rise and fall into the Mediterranean. And your command will be obeyed. That all that's required is that you really believe it and that you have no doubt. So listen to me. You can pray for anything. And if you believe, you have it. It's yours. But when you are praying, first forgive anyone that you're holding a grudge against, so that your Father in heaven will forgive you your sins too.
Little condition there. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we give you this night. We ask the precious Holy Spirit to come and anoint every word, every thought, every truth. Lord, take this Logos word and let it become Rhema, living word in every one of our hearts tonight. We pray in Jesus' precious name. Above all else, let souls be saved. Let bodies be healed. Let your body be lifted tonight to new heights of spiritual warfare and battle, that we may possess those things that you have ordained that we should have in Jesus' name. Lord, let it be done to the glory and honor of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. And all the church and the people said, amen, amen, amen. You better get your notebooks out. And you better get ready to take some notes, because the Word of Faith professor is here tonight, and he might ask questions. Let's sing it for Papa Hagen right now. One of the grand old songs, "The Longer I Serve Him, the Sweeter He Grows." Welcome, Vern Jackson.
I start for the kingdom since my life He controls. Since I gave my heart to Jesus, the Lord, the sweeter He grows. time, then His grace He bestows every day. My way gets brighter the longer I serve Him, the sweeter He grows. The longer I serve Him, the sweeter He grows. The more that I love Him, the more love He bestows. And each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve Him, the sweeter He grows. The longer I serve Him, the sweeter He grows. The more that I love Him, more love He bestows. And each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve Him, sweeter He grows.
Yes, 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 yes. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. The longer we serve Him, the sweeter He does grow. Well, it has been far too long since the Hagen family has been our special, I shouldn't say guest. No. This is part of our family here on the Praise the Lord program. But what a joy to have Reverend Kenneth Hagen Sr. and Kenneth Hagen Jr. as our very, very special, Bible teachers tonight, we will say. President and founder of Rhema Bible Training Center, 1974, as a child, bedfast for 16 months, totally paralyzed from a deformed heart, an incurable blood disease, actually died and went to hell.
Yeah.
But God rose him up, and we've got a little testimony we're going to touch on a little bit before we get into this word of faith. Just known worldwide as a great teacher of faith and the Word of God, an author of over 90 books. Let's tell Kenneth Hagen Sr., Dad Hagen, welcome to Praise the Lord tonight. And following right in his footsteps is the senior pastor of Rhema Bible Church, the executive vice president, chief executive officer of Kenneth Hagen Foreign Hagen Ministries, not Foreign Ministries, foreign and home,
yeah,
I'm sure.
Everywhere.
Obeying the call of God to minister alongside his dad, Kenneth Hagen Sr., author of more than 35 books and numerous ministry cassettes, Kenneth Hagen Jr., who will begin, along with Dad, a brand new television program, Madam Program Director.
Yes, I know.
Every Sunday morning,
yes,
at
I think it's like 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock
Pacific
time, which will be 9 o'clock Tulsa time.
Right.
Let's tell Kenneth Hagen Jr. Welcome to Praise the Lord tonight. How are you, sir?
Glad to be here.
Oh my goodness! I'd like to keep you here all night, but I know you've got to get out of here and get off the ground before a certain hour tonight. Let's touch quickly on that testimony. It's been a long time, Dad, since you've told us. You were just a young man. How old were you when this happened?
I was about 15 years old.
15 years old?
About 4 months before my 16th birthday.
And what was wrong with you again?
heart condition.
Okay.
I was born with a deformed heart. Okay. I never ran and played like other little children as a child. I had a limited childhood. And at 15, I became totally bedfast. Hmm. One of the number one doctor, in fact, Mayo Clinic said that he was number one surgeon of the world, one of the greatest doctors. He said no one in my condition had ever lived, medical science had any record of, had ever lived past the age of 16. Hmm. When I, 4 months before my 16th birthday, I became totally bedfast. On the 22nd day of April, 1933, Saturday night, at 7:30.
That memory.
At 7:30.
Now, may I interject that we just asked you how old you were down, yeah. Dad, and we could tell people, you tell them.
Yeah.
81 years, and 81. Still remembers the date and the time and the hour, yeah, and minute, sure. And the moment.
Amen.
I love that go.
Something along that line, if I had time, I'd share with you, but it'd take too long. So anyway, the doctor had already been called. Doctors made house calls in 1933.
Yes, sir.
But at 7:30 on the 22nd day of April, 1933, in the South Bedroom of 405 North College Street, the city of McKinney, Texas, my heart stopped.
Oh.
When my heart stopped, faster than you can snap your finger, you know, I felt the circulation cut off. My tongue, my toes just went numb. Hmm. Feet, ankles, stomach. I leaped out of my body, like a diver would leap off of a diving board in a swim pool. And I began to descend, down. Mm. I looked up, I could see the lights of the earth above me. But the further down you went, the darker it became. Till finally darkness encompassed me. Darkness is darker than any night you've ever seen.
Now, was your family Christian at that time? Did your mother?
Well, nominal Christians.
Just nominal Christians, okay.
It seemed to me if you'd had a knife, you could cut a chunk of that darkness out.
Ooh.
And once you went through the darkness, then down beneath me, I could see fingers of light flickering on the walls of darkness. And I came to the bottom of the pit. And I saw the gates of hell before me. Beyond the gates, giant orbs of flame, white crest.
Jesus.
And it pulled me like a magnet. You know, you just float. Mm. Mm-hmm. And I knew once I went through the gates, I couldn't come back, so I tried to slow my descent down. Mm. And there was a creature that met me. I don't know what he looked like. I didn't exactly look at him because my gaze was riveted to hell itself. But he took me by the right arm to escort me in. And later on, I found a scripture in Isaiah that said, hell from beneath is moved to meet thee at thy coming.
Ooh,
it stirreth
right.
up the dead for thee.
Wow.
Yes.
And so that creature took me by the arm to escort me in, and there was a voice that spoke away above the blackness. I don't know what he said because it wasn't English. I suppose 10 or 12 words. But when he spoke, that whole place shook like an earthquake was on. The creature took his hand off my arm. Like a suction to your back, like a magnet draws metal. I just floated back. Mm. And then I came up. I came up on the porch outside the house. I could see the giant trees in the yard. Went right through the wall, and I saw my body lying there. My grandmother was holding me in her arms. And I leaped inside my body through my mouth. I got back inside my body. I said to my grandmother, we called her Granny, I said, I'm going again. I don't know how I knew it. And I wanted to tell Mama goodbye. And so I left a word with her to tell each one of them goodbye. And I went again.
Wasn't there fear in your heart, though? What was your personal feelings at this time?
I'll tell you in a moment.
Okay.
Second time, same thing happened. Except the second time, I came up at the foot of the bed instead of on the porch. And I saw my body lying there on the bed, my grandmother holding me. I leaped from the foot of the bed, seemed like inside my mouth, in my body. And I said to my grandmother, I'm going again. I don't know how come I knew that. But I said, I'm going, and I won't be back this time. Mm. She said, son, I thought you wasn't coming back that time. Mm. And so I left the final word, and the third time. Now, up till now, I can't believe this is happening. I think it's a hallucination. And so when I got down into the darkness, I literally screamed, God, I belong to the church. I've been baptized in water. Mm. I'm trying to tell him I should be going this direction.
Mm.
But there's no answer. The only echo of my own voice as it resounded through the... And I screamed the second. I mean screamed. I don't mean just hollered.
Mm.
God, I belong to the church. I've been baptized in water. Same thing the third time, but there's no answer. I came to the bottom of the pit. Same thing happened. Same creature met me. Same voice spoke. And I came floating up. As I began to come up, I began to pray and ask God to forgive me and save me, even though I was a church member, I thought I was saved. And this time I came up at the side of the bed. And when I got back inside my body, my mouth picked up my prayer right in the middle of a sentence and continued to pray. And I looked at the clock. It felt to me like a 2-ton weight rolled off of my chest. I looked at the clock on Grandpa's mantelpiece and said, 20 minutes till 8. All that happened in 10 minutes. So I was born again, 20 minutes till 8, Saturday night, 1933. Amen. 22nd day of April.
But now you're back in your body, but you're still not really healed yet, are you?
No, oh no, I'm bedfast. I don't know a thing about healing. I thought I had to die. Medical science said I had to die.
Yes.
And so I waited to die. And
at least you're saved now.
Yeah, at least I'm saved.
Yes.
Now on the 20s, on the...
Now to get saved, all you had to do was say what?
Jesus. Ask God to forgive me in Jesus' name and accept Him as Savior.
And that was it?
That was it. That was it.
We make it so hard, don't we, sometimes?
Oh.
Yeah.
Now, 4 months later, on August the 16th, 1933, 1:30 in the afternoon. Now, you see, I was sick at home, you know. We didn't have all the... We had hospitals, but not like we do now. No intensive care and all that, you know.
No.
But no one was allowed in my room but one person at a time. Doctors, like we said, made house calls. So I said to my youngest brother, run and get Mama quick. I'm dying. I knew because I'd been dead. I'm dying. And so he ran out of the room to get her, and I left my body, and I began to ascend.
Oh.
I went up. Actually, the whole room filled with a white cloud. You've seen the sun shining on snow?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
Dazzling. The glory of God. You remember the scripture said, the psalmist said, He'll guide me with His eye, and after He will receive me to glory.
Yes.
And the whole room lit up. And I went up. I got up about where the top of the house should be, not the ceiling, the roof of the house. And I heard these words. I didn't see anybody, but I believe it was Jesus. These words in the English language. Now down there, I don't know what the tongue was. It's foreign tongue. But the English language said, go back, go back, go back to the earth. You can't come yet. Your work on earth's not done. And so I descended. I came back down into the room. I saw my body lying on the bed. I saw my mother stooped over me with my hand in hers. Again, I leaped inside my body and I said, Mama, I'm not going to die now. She thought I meant I'm not going to die now this minute. I meant I'm not going to die now. I'm going to live and do the work of God. I didn't know how, but now that was so sacred. I never said anything about that for 25 years.
Really?
See, some things too sacred to talk about.
Yes, sir.
But in talking about what it means to believe with the heart, the inward man, to prove, you see, that the inward man is an eternal being.
Yes, sir.
I give scriptures, and then the Lord said, give that experience. So I began to give it. My mother heard me on the radio, and she said, son, you know, I never heard that before. I said, well, it's too sacred. I couldn't talk about it. But she said, the way you tell it, that just happened in a few seconds. I said, well, yeah. Well, let me tell you our side. Said, Pat come running back to the kitchen, said, Mama, Mama, Granny, Granny, Ken's dying. She said, I was close to the door, and I ran up the hallway through the dining room into your bedroom, and I couldn't get in the bedroom. Wow. It was filled with a cloud.
Wow.
You couldn't enter in.
Wow.
And so I backed off against the dining room table and stood there and prayed, and Granny, Mama, her mama, came right behind her. She didn't look. She hit the open door now and bounced back like you'd run into a giant rubber ball.
Jesus.
She backed up halfway of the dining room, made another run, couldn't get in. She backed all the way across the dining room, run the third time, and said, she said, why, Lily, you can't see. The room's filled with a cloud. Yeah, I can't see the bed. I can't see the chest of drawers. I can't see the rocker. I can't see Ken. And hung on to the door facing to keep him falling. She said it was 10 minutes before we could get in the room. Oh, we couldn't get in until the cloud lifted.
Mm. Lord have mercy.
Praise God.
Wow. Well, is that when you were healed then?
No.
Not yet.
A year later, I was healed.
Well, now tell me about that.
Now,
what was the glory cloud about? What were you experiencing when that was going on?
Well, the Word of God said, you remember, concerning Stephen, when he was stoned, the first martyr.
Yes, he saw
Jesus stands right hand of the Father. He saw the glory of God and Jesus. Mm-hmm. The glory of God. The glory of God appeared all through the Old Testament, filled the temple as a cloud when it dedicated it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Priests couldn't stand to minister.
Mm-hmm. What years later now, what was the purpose of that glory cloud at that time in your room? What was the purpose of that?
No purpose of it. In other words, that's where everybody goes when they die as a Christian.
Okay, okay.
Thou wilt guide me with thine eye, the psalmist said, and afterwards receive me to glory.
Into glory, okay.
There is a glory world.
Yeah, oh yes. You've seen it, haven't you?
Yeah, I've seen it. Well, as I said, I waited to die because the doctor said I had to die. Mm-hmm. But I couldn't get into the Bible. You know, it took me from April till November to get through Matthew and into Mark. Mm-hmm. Because you see, I could read sometime 10 minutes a day and then I can't see. I mean, all I see is a white page with black dots. Mm-hmm. And I lay in a stupor the rest of the day. Mm-hmm. And during the summer, I was in a coma 9 weeks out of the 13. Mm-hmm. I'd come to and ask Mama, what time is it? She'd tell me what day it is. Mm-hmm. And so in November, though, I got into Mark 11, 23, and 24. I got that far. Mm. When I read those verses, something inside me said, that's where it is. Mm. That's it.
Okay.
And so then, I still didn't know how to exercise my faith, you see, because I had been taught, and I asked Christians, and they all said healing's been done away with.
Yes.
See?
Now, Mark 11, 23, for the folks, yeah, Jan read it from the Living Bible,
quote.
But quote it from
King James.
The good old King. How did he say it?
Whosoever shall say unto this mountain shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe those things which he saith, shall come to pass, he'll have whatsoever he saith. Therefore I say unto you, what things ever you desire when you pray, believe you receive them, and you shall have them.
Okay.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, you see, the devil said to me, and you know, I didn't know it was the devil at the time. You know, the way we say something said to your mind. That doesn't mean whatever you desire physically or financially. That just means what things whatever you desire
spiritually. I see.
But I stopped in November to see a reading, at reading Matthew or Mark 11, 23 and 24. And I, something inside me said, did you notice, and I read over it now, did you notice the woman with the issue of blood in the fifth chapter of Mark, that her faith made her whole?
That's what Jesus said, isn't it?
I said, no, I didn't notice that. So I couldn't, you see, I became, you know, at times totally paralyzed and then partially all the time. In other words, the day I was healed, my mother bathed me. I was a kid, couldn't bathe myself. I regained some use of the upper part of my body. From my waist down, I didn't have any feel. I didn't feel like there was anything down there. Mm. But I couldn't pick up a page and turn it. I could move my hand and scoot it across the page. It'd take me sometime 10 minutes to move one page. Mm. I got back to the fifth chapter of Mark and began to read the 25th verse. There's a certain woman with the issue of blood who suffered many things and many physicians was nothing better, but rather grew worse. When she heard of Jesus, came in the press behind, touched his garment, for she said, if I may but touch his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up. She felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And immediately Jesus, knowing within himself that virtue, or power, the Greek said, had gone out of him, turned him about and said, who touched me? The disciple said, the multitude thronged thee, and sayest thou, who touched me? But the woman, fearing and trembling, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. Now, verse 34. Jesus said, daughter, thy faith has made thee whole.
Yes, yes.
I said, that's right. That's right. And then that inward voice said, did you ever hear anybody say faith's been done away with? See, they said healing's been done away with.
Yeah, yeah.
See, I stopped and thought about all my Sunday school teachers, pastors. No, I said, never heard anybody say faith's been done away with. The inward voice said, no, and you never will. Mm-hmm. For Ephesians 2:8 said, by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself is a gift of God. So if faith's been done away with, then there's nobody saved.
Oh.
If faith, that's what the inward voice said.
Yes.
If faith's been done away with, then there is no church.
Yeah.
Then there are no believers.
Now the Lord's talking.
I said, that's right. Then the inward voice said, if her faith made her whole, your faith can make you whole.
Wow.
Oh, now we're getting close.
Now, from November 1933 till August of 1934, see, 9 more months, I'm still bedfast. Now, if somebody had come into my room with a baseball bat and said, we're going to beat you from the top of your head to the soles of your feet till you die, or else you say your faith won't make you whole, I said, start beating, I'll die.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes.
But I didn't know how to turn my faith loose.
Ah.
I couldn't make it work for me.
There's a key, isn't there?
But there is. But you see, it's so simple when you see it. Now, on the 8th day of August, 1934, then, Mama had bathed me, left me propped up on a couple of pillows, my Bible open to Mark 11, 23, and 24. And so I said to the Lord in prayer, now, Lord Jesus, if you stood here by my bedside in the flesh and held my hand like Mama does sometimes, looked down in my face, said, son, your problem is you don't believe. Now, I'd already said to him, you said right here in your word, when you pray, I prayed. You said, believe. I said, I believe. I said, I'd have to say to you, I said it kindly, I said, I'd have to say to you, dear Lord Jesus, you're lying about it. I do believe.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Then, you see, Jesus said when he's come talking about the Spirit of truth, he'll not speak of himself. He does speak. But he'll not speak of himself, but whatever he hears, he'll speak. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So the Holy Ghost who's in you, if you're born again and a Christian, then he'll say whatever Jesus said.
Sure.
So he said, you do believe, all right, as far as you know. That's the second revelation on faith I received. Mm-hmm. You can't believe beyond actual knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You do believe as far as you know. Secondly, that means I don't know enough.
Okay.
If you don't have enough faith, it's because you don't know enough. Mm-hmm. And then he said, but that last clause goes with that verse. And quote, and ye shall have them. Now you see, what things ever you desire, when you pray, believe you receive them, and you'll have them.
And you shall have them.
I said, I see it. I see it. Now, I didn't mean to start with my head. I mean, I got it here. I see it. While I'm still lying here paralyzed, I haven't moved a peg, I got to believe I receive healing from paralysis. Mm-hmm. While my heart's still not beating right, I got to believe I receive healing for the deformed heart. While the doctor said, if you didn't have anything else, then it's incurable blood disease alone would prove to be fatal to you. I got to believe I receive it. My position is I got to believe I receive my healing. His is he sees to it I have it.
Okay.
So I began to say out loud, I believe I receive healing. I believe my heart's healed. I believe paralysis healed. I had no evidence of it.
Now, is that then the key? To
the
speak
key.
It out
say
loud?
Say with your mouth. Later on, the Lord said to me in teaching, he said, go teach my people, May of 1950, go teach my people faith. I've taught you faith through my word. I permitted you to go through certain experiences. Now, and you've learned faith both by my word and through experience. Now go teach my people what I've taught you. Mm-hmm. And so I've done that. I've been faithful to do that. Well, he said to me, Mark 11, 23 said, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe those things which he saith shall come to pass, he'll have whatsoever he saith. He said to me, the word say or saith is in that verse 3 times, the word believes in that verse once. Mm-hmm. People have been taught to believe, but he said you'll have to do 3 times as much teaching on the saying part mm-hmm. than you do on the believing part to get people to see it.
So it's the Amen. Saying of it.
Yeah. That's how you release your faith. That's how you turn your faith loose.
That's how you're saved in the first place.
How you're saved in the first place.
Yes.
With your mouth,
same
the Lord
spirit
Jesus.
Of faith.
For yeah. with the heart man believeth, and with the mouth
confession
is made unto salvation.
Absolutely. Same right. thing's true.
Same way you get healed.
Same way you get healed. Same way you get filled with the Spirit. Same way you get an answer to prayer.
You simply, okay. Mm-hmm. If somebody's sick out there right now, what would you tell them to do?
Well, I'd tell them, primarily, first of all, if they're Christian, get into the Word for themselves.
Yes, sir.
And act on that Word and begin to confess that Word and say, according to the Word of God, I have this or I have that,
okay.
Whatever it is that they're seeking for.
Did you begin to do that then?
Oh, yeah, I began to do that.
How long before you had the manifestation then of your healing?
Well, in my case, within the hour, I was standing out of the bed well.
Oh, you're kidding.
In an hour?
Yeah.
Within the hour?
Within the hour. See, I began, now I never heard anybody praise God in my life. I never heard anybody say, praise the Lord. I never heard anybody say, hallelujah.
No.
I'd heard people say amen at the end of a prayer, that's all. See? But I had an urge from within to praise God. Mm-hmm. And so I began to do that. Mm-hmm. And I began to say, praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for my healing. Praise God.
Yes.
And then I heard these words, see? The Holy Ghost is repeating the words of Jesus. Now you believe that you are well. Believe that you are well.
Okay.
I said, I certainly do. Well, I haven't moved a peg. I'm still paralyzed. I've got every symptom I ever had. But I believe I'm well. Mm-hmm. He said, get up then.
Oh.
Well, people ought to be up at 10:30 in the morning. Well, I made an effort to get up. I had to push my feet off the bed. I had some use of my arms, and I just wrapped them around a bedpost and, you know, and leaned over here, mm-hmm. my knees sagging against the floor. And I said, in that position, no evidence, but I said, in the presence of Almighty God, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, the holy angels, mm-hmm. and the devil and all of his cohorts.
I say
what? I want
what?
To announce, according to the Word of God, I'm healed.
Whoa! Hallelujah!
And at that time, I felt.
Anybody else is listening?
Something struck me at the top of the head like a warm glow.
Ooh,
and it oozed down over my body like somebody poured a pitcher of honey on you, you know?
Yes, sir.
Oozed down over me. When it went down my legs began to hurt. I had no feeling. Mm-hmm. Like somebody's sticking 10,000 pins in your legs. I told folks it hurt so bad I could have cried if it hadn't felt so good. See, you don't have
life was coming back. And, yes.
And I'm standing up straight.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen.
What did Mama say?
64 years have come and gone, and I'm still healed.
But what did your mother say when
Grandma.
She's and Granny? What did they say?
Well, they really didn't say anything. Mama tried to talk me out of it.
Really?
I went to the table to sit down to eat, and Grandpa said, "Is the dead raised? Is Lazarus raised up?" I said, "Yeah, it sure is."
Oh my goodness!
Amen.
They didn't talk much back then.
No.
That's incredible.
Praise God.
Oh my
You'd have think the whole household would have been swinging from the chandelier, praising God.
Yeah.
But you came from a pretty formal
That's it.
Church, apparently.
Oh, yeah.
I see.
Wow.
Oh, Dad, this
praise
is...
God.
See, this is the key. This is the key.
Oh,
this
is
the
it.
Key.
That's it.
Ken Jr., tell us, I mean, starting what? May the...
Third.
The third.
Right.
Now... If you've just gotten a little taste, I mean, there is so much more to this. So we've finally found a time.
Praise
every
God.
Sunday morning at 7 o'clock. That'll be 9 o'clock Tulsa time, uh-huh. 10 o'clock on the East Coast. But this Word of Faith, what? It's going to be taught every week right here
right.
on Trinity Broadcast.
Out of the church, Rhema Bible Church, Rhema Praise, we call it.
Okay.
And we'll be preaching and teaching faith in at the church. And we get about... We got about 9,700 members, and we get about 5,000 of them there every Sunday morning, and we just have a good time in the Lord. Sometimes the Holy Ghost falls, and I pray for the sick, and we don't even get any preaching.
You told me that Rhema Ministries worldwide now, though, God has mightily blessed you. Give me a quick little overview before I ask you another question here.
All right, we've got... 18,000 graduates from Rhema Bible Training Center in the last 20, we're graduating 24th class this year. We've got graduates in 95 countries preaching the gospel. Hmm. We got Rhema grads on every continent preaching the gospel, even down in Antarctica. We just heard about it two years ago, wasn't it, Dad? That we heard we have two Rhema grads down there that are holding Bible studies with the scientist teams that are down there doing those all those Praise experiments God. And stuff. We have 1,200 pastors that are pastoring churches here in America that are Rhema grads and part of the Rhema Ministerial Fellowship. And that doesn't count all of the associates and the evangelists and the children's ministers and the youth ministers and the music ministers. That's just
pastors. The word of faith is going around the world, in other words, isn't it, right now?
And we got a 100-acre campus with 12 buildings now. So we've grown Hallelujah. Since the last time we was on the program with
you. Lord.
God has just been blessing us.
That's so wonderful. You sent me a little tape, Ken, and I listened to your message, and the truth is so powerful. And it sort of ties in with Jan's favorite little scripture, 1 Corinthians 13, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I'm nothing, is basically what that scripture says.
Right.
And you pointed out that it was a powerful word. You know, you can have spiritual gifts, you can have faith, you can have all these wonderful other things, stuff that Pop's been talking about
here,
but none of it works, does it, without love.
Faith, Paul said, faith works by love.
Right.
A lot of people have faith and they really believe God and they really have faith, but they're still not getting anything. It's because they're not walking in love toward their fellow man. They're not walking in love toward their family. They're not walking in love toward anybody.
How do they change that?
Well, they simply have to begin to get a hold of the Word of God and remember what He said. He said, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, all thy mind, all thy soul, all thy being, every part of you, your spirit, soul, body, everything. Love God with all your heart. And then practice the commandment of the New Testament. See, the New Testament's only one commandment in the New Testament, the commandment of love. Mm-hmm. That is, and Jesus gave it there in the Gospels. And if you live according to the commandment of love, you won't break any of the ten.
No commandment.
Ooh.
That's the secret of living in love. But you see, if you have love, you will have relationships. And that is a key that the Lord's been dealing with me about here lately. And I'm going to come out with some teaching in a series on that pretty soon on relationships. There, in fact, in my teaching on home and family, I got a four-tape video series, or three-tape video series called, I taught it at the church called, Is Your House Really a Home? I deal with love, I deal with a couple other things, and then I deal with something that is very important. Rules without relationship bring rebellion. That's what's happening with a lot of Christians. They're having trouble coming in line with the Word of God because they don't have a relationship with God. They've accepted Jesus at some time in their life, but they have never established a relationship with God. Therefore, when the rules of God start to be applied to their life, they begin to buck and begin to go another direction. When they try to start believing God for finances, start to try believing God for healing, believing God for anything, they don't get anything because they don't have any love, they don't have any relationship with God. I learned this from him as a boy growing up. Yeah. I learned this at home around my kitchen table.
And love is basically just a choice, isn't it?
It's a choice.
You choose. So what you're telling me then is all of this good stuff that Dad's been talking to us about, none of it works unless...
You have love.
You have love.
Do you know what... Everybody talks about him, about his faith. Do you know the greatest thing about him? It's his love walk. I'll be 59 years old this year. I lived in his house until I was 20, well, I went to the Army when I was 22, I guess. And then been with him all these years, working with him, ministering with him, and I have never heard him say anything bad about anybody. In fact, people will come and ask him about some things, and he might know something about something, and Mother would say, after they'd leave, she said, why didn't you tell them something so they wouldn't get in trouble? He said, I don't want anything to come out of my mouth against anybody else. Said, I'll pray that the Lord will direct them. Yeah. But he said, I don't believe it's my responsibility to speak bad about anybody. In all of the years that I've been with him, since I can remember, I have never, ever heard him speak evil against anybody. And he taught me this, and I still live by this, never hold a grudge against anybody.
Amen.
No matter what
Amen.
They do, what they say, or anything else. Amen. And I patterned my life by that, and I preach that way, and I preach to the church that way.
Because if you hold hardness and bitterness in your heart,
love goes out the other direction.
Love's gone. And really, it doesn't hurt that person. It hurts you.
It hurts you. It stops you from receiving from God.
Exactly.
That's
exactly.
What it's all about. Love.
Well,
all right.
Walk in health, spiritually, mentally, or physically, you're going to have to walk in love.
Yes, sir.
I tell people, you know, I've been healed now for 64 years. Last headache I had was August 1933.
I had one this afternoon.
I don't have headaches. Never had a headache.
I need your book again, Dad.
Amen. Let me give you an illustration real quickly about love.
Okay.
What can we do? Mm-hmm. Without going into great detail about it, my wife and I were holding a meeting in an adjoining state a number of years ago, and a young minister and his wife, both of them actually were ordained ministers, Pentecostal. We didn't know until we held a meeting, not far then, they went to this church in this hometown, that their youngest child, 3 years of age, had epilepsy. They brought to a doctor here in Los Angeles, and the doctor said it was the worst case he'd ever seen in 38 years of practice. Mm. Well, they're trying to believe God for the healing of that child. Now, when we started the meeting, they invited my wife and I the very first night to go have a sandwich with them after church. And so we were eating, and she said, "Brother Hagin, you've got me in trouble."
How so?
I said, "Oh, no, you was in trouble before I got here. Word of God just showed it up. Well, what's the problem?" "Well," said, "you said tonight in your sermon," I quoted from 1 John 3, 14 and 15, where he said, "He that hateth his brother is a murderer. You know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him." And I added, "He that hateth his brother," I said, "that means mother-in-law too."
Oh. Uh-oh.
Well, it means anyone.
Yeah,
Lord,
sure.
But I just happened to say that. And so I said, "Well, what's your problem?" I said, "Well, I hate my mother-in-law."
Oh, dear. You put your finger right on it.
Put my finger right on it, see?
Wow. Mm.
Well, I said, I knew she really didn't. What, instead of letting her love, that see, the love of God shed abroad in our hearts. But people let their head dominate them. Mm-hmm. I said, "Look me in the eye and say, I hate my mother-in-law, and check here." So she reached over the table and said, "Well, I hate my mother-in-law." I said, "What happened?" She said, "There's something down there scratching me." I said, "The love of God trying to constrain you."
Mm-hmm.
Well, she said, "What am I going to do?" Here's the secret. I said, "Act like you would if you did love them, because you do."
Oh.
Love, like faith, is revealed in action and word.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Well, a few nights later, I said to my wife on Friday night, we had no service, said, "I've invited my mother-in-law and my sisters-in-law and their brother-in-law to come to my house for refreshment." Hadn't been having anything to do with one another.
Mm-hmm.
So we, and invited us to go, we went. That's when I found out the child had epilepsy. She went around and whispered me, said, "You're right, I don't hate them." Said, "They're lovely Christians," and I was wrong. Well, they're trying to believe God for the healing. You go through a preliminary attack before you go into the main seizure, the way I understand it.
Mm-hmm.
They give you some medication that'll help, but it doesn't stop them. So just before we went to church, she called to see, would I come by? The child was gone in this preliminary attack. Would you come by and pray? Well, the Lord said, "Go," unless he says go, I don't go, because if you went for one, you had to go for all of them. And so we went. Now, we got in the car and started. My wife and I sat in the front seat. Nobody in the back seat. But to me, it just as real as somebody sitting in the back seat said, "Don't pray for the child. Don't lay hands on the child. Don't know a child. Don't know it, anoint the child with oil. When you get there, say to the mother, I said to Israel, walk in my statutes and my commandments. Do that which is right in my sight, and I'll take sickness away from the midst of you. The number of your days you'll fulfill." Paraphrasing that in New Testament language, you walk in my commandment of love. Keep my precept of love. Do that which is right in my sight, which is to walk in love. See, that covers all of them.
Yes, sir.
I'll take sickness away from the midst of you. The number of your days you fulfill. Say, mother, say to Satan, Satan, I'm walking in love. Take your hand off my child. Ooh. I mean, fast, I got down my mouth. Now, that child's in this seizure. Oh,
Yeah.
She turned and said, Satan, I'm walking in love. Take your hand off my child. My wife will tell you, she's right there. Fast you snap your finger, that's it.
Whoa. Oh. Hallelujah.
The little girl, the baby's a grandmother today.
The Lord needs a hand on that one, I'll tell you.
Amen. But see, that'll work for anybody. See, now a few weeks before, she's not walking in love, but now she's got into love.
But it was a choice, wasn't it?
Choice. See?
Yeah.
So how are you going to do it? How are you going to do it? Act like you would if you did love her, because you do.
Whoa. There's another key now.
That's it.
There's another key.
Excuse me, didn't mean to butt in.
Oh, that's all right. This is good. Are y'all taking notes? Everybody getting a hold of this up there?
Paul, here's an interesting thing. See, what's Tony's? Is he RMAI? What is he?
Well, he's over the RMAI. He's also associate pastor at the church.
Yeah, he's associate pastor, but he's also over at Rhema Ministerial Associate. I had a little note from him. He said last year, a Rhema graduate, started a church that has pioneered a new work, or else accepted the pastor of a church every 2.5 days.
Hallelujah.
That's still happening. That's still happening today.
We run into it everywhere.
Oh, absolutely.
Everywhere.
Before you leave, I got one more question.
All right.
Vern Jackson's going to sing you one more song, Why Me, Lord, but I'll get you out of here by 8:30, okay?
All right. Fine. Like you
said.
Sound good.
He loves you anyway.
I'm a Christian. Am I supposed to be poor? Don't answer that just yet. We'll answer that in just a minute. And there's some good truths and some good teaching that's coming through from two of God's great servants, Reverend Kenneth Hagin, Sr. and Jr. And in a minute, we'll give you a little address for those of you that want to get in touch. When does school when do you need to write and get the catalog and start thinking about
it? Right now. You can write and get it right now. We're filling out applications, accepting students at this present time.
There it is, even as we speak. PO Box, is that right? 50126, Tulsa, Oklahoma.
Right, that's it. Also, we are now, Rhema Bible Training Center, we now in the NBCAA, the National Bible College Athletic Association, and we have a basketball team. Now, you have to come to school. There's no scholarships or anything, but you come to school first to study for the ministry. But if some of the guys out there, and girls, because we have a girls team too, that they play basketball, they can study for the ministry, and they get a little icing on the cake too, play a little basketball with
them. Why not? We
had one of our boys just graduate from over here in California. He was on the team, and now he's at ORU finishing up and going to be on their team.
If this song had been written back at the time Brother Hagin was going through all of this sickness and everything, this would have been a good song. Why me, Lord?
What did I ever do
to deserve even one of the blessings you give? Let's tell Vern Jackson we love him as he sings. Keep your Bibles out.
Deserve even one of the blessings I've known. Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do that was worth loving you for the kindness you've shown? Lord, help me. Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hands. Try me, Lord, if you think there's a way I can try to repay all I've taken from you. maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I've been through myself on my way back to you. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it, so help me, Jesus, I know what I am.
Yes, I do, Lord.
Now that I know that I've needed you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. My soul's in your hand.
Thank you, Vern. Beautiful, beautiful song. And look at, people are getting saved. That's what we ask the Lord
Amen.
For tonight.
Amen.
As they've heard this tremendous testimony, Brother Hagin, about how the Lord brought you literally back from the dead. And you gave your heart to Jesus. They said, we want to be saved too. Can't read them all, but Cecil from Killeen, Texas, 53 years old, for the first time gave his heart to Jesus tonight.
17.
And here's Adam from Santa Ana, California, 17.
Praise the Lord.
For the first time giving his heart to Jesus. And there's probably 100 here that have given their lives to the Lord Jesus. You know, one quick little thing aside here, real quickly. Jan just asked off while Vern was singing, said, now, Dad, come on. Really, you haven't had a headache since 1933? Mm-hmm. And then you said...
I said, have you ever had the symptom of any sickness? And if you had, what do you do immediately?
And you said?
I said, I've had symptoms of headaches three times in 64 years, and I resist them.
How do you resist it?
Well, I refuse to have it.
How do you do that?
Just say, headache leave.
Just like that.
Just like that. And every single time they left.
It's that spoken word again, isn't it?
Mouth. Yeah, yeah.
Whosoever says say to the mountain, whether it's a headache or a or a real mountain.
And I haven't had the flu in all these years. Now, three times I've had symptoms that lasted for 10 minutes. One time I had more of a struggle, an hour and a half. But then every symptom left me.
In that hour and a half, what were you saying?
Constantly saying, I refuse. The devil said, you got it. Well, you got it this time. I said, no, I don't have it. I refuse to accept it.
Yeah.
Paul, in
it's
all the years.
Mine. It's not mine.
All the years, the only time I've ever seen him with symptoms of sickness, I've never seen him really, really sick, but the only time I've ever seen him with symptoms of sickness is when God was dealing with him to do something, and he didn't do it. And the minute that he asked God to forgive him and started doing it and said he would do it, gone. Just
it's
like
gone.
That. Just like you snap your fingers.
That's it.
Boy, there's some truths here that we needed a little refresher course.
Praise God.
In
well,
faith.
You need to be constantly reminded.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Do you have a little word, sweetie, before
we... somebody sent me this today, and, you know, I really didn't know if it would fit in tonight, but I think it does, because it's about people who have faults and how we want to criticize and want to not love certain people for certain things. And then in the end, we see that the answer is love, and that's just what you were talking about. Someone sent me this, and I love for people to do that. It says, I'll pray, not find fault with the man who limps and stumbles along the road. Because unless I've worn the shoes that he wears, I have struggled beneath his load. There may be tacks in his shoes that hurt, though hidden away from my view. And the burdens he bears, if placed on my back, might cause me to stumble too. Mm. I may be strong, but still the blows that were his, if dealt to me, in the same self way and the same self time, might cause me to stagger too. I'll not speak too harsh to that man that sins, or pelt him with words of stone, unless I am sure, yes, doubly sure, that I've not a single sin of my own. I'd not do as he did. I'd not say what he said. I'd not, there, I've said it again. Did I sin more than he by just saying the words? I'd not ever do that sin. For you know, perhaps if the old tempter's voice had whispered the same to me as it did to him when he was oh so weak, would it have caused me to stumble too? So love is the way, the only way, and we all know that this is true. For when we were all destined to go to hell for our sins, I heard, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do.
Sweet. Beautiful.
Just kind of a reminder that we love to criticize, we love to strike out and hurt other people, but that's not the way.
No.
We're all just sinners saved by grace.
Amen. You know, there's one other little thing before we talk just a minute about, and we've got 27 minutes before I have to let you get to the airplane. Yeah.
On this April the 23rd.
On this April the 23rd.
23rd.
At 10 minutes past 8 o'clock.
Yeah. Close to
3 minutes past 8 o'clock.
Yeah. Yeah.
3 minutes past 8 o'clock. I have learned so much, not only about faith, but many other things from Brother Hagin through the years. And I'll never forget, honey, at, I believe it was at, it was up at Brother Fred Price's church. Mm-hmm. You were ministering up there. And I wasn't all this sure about being slain in the spirit.
Falling.
And I'll never. Everybody else, but not him.
You know, us Germans don't get slain very easy. And, you know, some people get slain in the spirit, but some of us have to stay on our feet to direct traffic. But I'll never forget, Dad, you came along and Jan and I were standing. We were just getting started. This was back in the 70s, way back there.
You probably know exactly when.
You probably remember the date.
75.
But you came along and you laid your hands on Jan and me. And that was the night also that the holy laughter came upon you. And we all began to laugh. In fact, I've got a little clip. It's only about a minute long, so we'll take a minute of your time. But I, for the first time, now, you know, some people kind of swoon. Some people, I think, kind of feel obligated to be slain in the spirit. But I want to tell you something. This was real. I mean, God came down and knocked the slats out of me. And I went under the power of the Holy Spirit, and it was a glorious experience. And I don't really know why God does that. Why does God do
just
that?
Just to bless you.
Just to bless you.
Bless you, yeah.
Because it does.
Yeah.
Well, it does. Well, it's we all blessing. Got blessed that night. And watch your screen there for just a minute, because you got blessed that night. Now watch. This will bring. You'll tell me the date here in a minute, won't it? This is what.
Oh,
Hallelujah. Somebody's. Oh, my Sakalora, maybe Anna could see me. Oh, baby. Amen. Praise God. Well, I know we like to be sedate. Everything in good order.
Now, you remember that like it was yesterday. I think you said it was June of 74.
Yeah, 75, I think.
Or 75. What was, okay, what was so funny?
Well, no, you get to last in the Spirit just because you get blessed.
Just the blessing of the Lord.
The joy.
It's just the joy of the Lord.
Joy of the Holy Ghost.
Of the Holy Ghost.
Says in the Spirit.
Joy of the Holy Ghost.
Joy unspeakable and full of glory.
That will heal depression.
Sure.
The joy of the Holy Ghost.
The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Joy.
Hallelujah.
And God sends a revival of joy. Just like sometimes we need a revival of healing because that truth needs to be revived.
I'll take some of it tonight.
Do you remember what Matthew said, our son, when he was directing that night? Do you remember that? He was directing out in the booth.
He's in a truck.
And he came around after that, and he had tears in his eyes after he was directing that night when this happened to the joy of the Holy Spirit.
He was just a young boy
at the time. And he said, you know, Mama, said, the Holy Spirit filled that truck where they were directing, and he said, I literally, the Holy Spirit came so strong in that truck, he said, I couldn't even see the buttons. He said, I was literally just in the Spirit directing, because he said it was so real in that room.
Hallelujah.
He said,
amen.
We
praise
just, God. I mean, we all in the auditorium that night, it was just unreal. People were slain, healed, blessed.
Oh,
it was unreal.
You and I went down together, and we were going through some pretty deep waters at that time, Brother Hagin, because TBN was just coming to birth, just being born at that time, and boy, Satan had thrown, he's still throwing everything but the kitchen sink at us right now.
Yeah,
but I've learned a few things,
praise
how
God.
To stand my ground.
Hallelujah.
Now, are we supposed to be poor?
Though he was rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, speaking of Jesus, that through his poverty we might be rich. Now, that's been used by many to say, if you're going to be a sweet, humble Christian, you should be poor.
Like Jesus.
Well, you notice,
like Jesus.
You notice the fact, though, was that we might be rich. If he's talking about him being poor from that standpoint, then it said that he bore our poverty that we might not have to bear poverty, because he said that you might be rich. He
but see, they all say that spiritual. That only means spiritual riches. We're only supposed to be spiritually rich.
That's what they
rich.
Said about, and what the devil said about Mark 11, 23 and 24.
What was that?
That just applies to spiritual blessings. It don't mean physical or material or financial.
He lied to you, didn't he?
Yeah, that's right.
And Jesus didn't become spiritually poor.
Oh, no, no.
He became physically poor. There's no way they would say
that. The spiritual poor couldn't heal the sick and raise the dead. But the thing about it is you can't build anything on one verse.
True.
That is doctrine.
Right.
But, because we are well taught, you know, our failure, the right teaching. I tell folks, I began as Baptist. And we Baptists, you know, prayed for the pastor, Lord, you keep him humble, we'll keep him poor.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Then I got baptized with the Holy Ghost, spoke with other tongues, got over among the Pentecostals, and they doubled up on it.
It was worse.
Yeah, Lord, you keep him humble, we'll keep him poor. And I pastored 12 years. More than one church, actually four churches over the 12-year period. And we struggled financially.
I can vouch for that.
We struggled financially.
You have a witness.
I got a witness on that one, brother.
Because I didn't know what I know now or what the Bible teaches.
Yes, sir.
And so by the leading of the Lord, I left my last church in 1949, went on what we call field ministry, going from church to church holding revival meetings.
Yes, sir.
Well, I'm out there a year. I wore my car out. And you just had to sell it for junk. You can't sell it, you know what I mean. I got enough money out of it, I think it's $150. I got enough money out of it to buy the kids a few clothes and to pay the interest on a note I had in East Texas, in Henderson, Texas, the First National Bank. Minister there went on my note. Then a note I had at People's State Bank in Tyler, Texas, one of my deacons, last church I pastor, went on my note. Then the First National Bank in Garland, Texas, another note. Brother Wood, the local pastor, went on my note.
And that $150 paid all that off, did it?
Paid the interest.
Paid the interest on it, I
plus buying a few clothes.
I see.
I laid out on the field a foot. So I got it all down on a sheet of paper. I got a hold of the verse in the Bible where God said, if ye be willing and obedient, you'll eat the good of the land. Mm-hmm. Well, if you eat the good of the land, that means you'll be on top.
Yes, sir.
And so I said, now, Lord, I left my church, and I really didn't want to leave. And my church, here's what they paid me last year, the last year I was there. Plus, they furnished a parsonage with all utilities. Plus, they sent my wife and I to conventions necessary to go to. Paid our way, the hotel bill and everything. Mm-hmm. Usually buy us a new suit to go, a new dress. Mm-hmm. Plus, it's always bringing us something to eat, probably fed us half of what we ate. Mm-hmm. Now, here, I got a third as much money as the church paid me. Plus, I had to pay my own rent. Plus, I had all my traveling expenses. Plus, I had to go to convention at my own expense. We're living in a three-room, not three-bedroom, three-room apartment. Ken has to sleep in the bed out on the back porch in the summertime in the kitchen, sleep on a rollaway bed in the kitchen. We're not eating the good of the land. My children are not adequately clothed.
What's wrong?
They're not adequately fed. And I said, you said if you'd be willing and obedient, you'll eat the good of the land. And I fasted. I'm in a meeting. I preached every night. We had no day services then. But I said, but I went on to fast. And the third day of my fast, the Lord said, the reason you're not eating the good of the land is you don't qualify.
What?
You don't qualify.
Why?
Well, I grabbed my stomach. My stomach felt like somebody hit me in the stomach with a fist. I mean, it really literally hurt. I said, Lord, you've hit me a low blow. I obeyed you. You said if you'd be willing and obedient. I obeyed you. Yeah, but he said you weren't willing.
Oh.
You just got through saying I'd rather stay there.
Okay.
Now, it didn't take me 10 seconds to get willing.
I see.
I mean, I made a little adjustment right down in here.
Willing
and then
adjustment.
I said to the Lord, Lord, I'm willing. I know I'm willing. God knows I'm willing. You know I'm willing. The Holy Ghost knows I'm willing. The devil knows I'm willing.
Okay. You're talking again now.
I'm
speaking.
I'm talking.
Yes.
But you see, you can be willing and obedient, and yet you're wrong thinking. And if you think wrong, you believe wrong. And if you believe wrong, you'll talk wrong. Has to be corrected.
Yeah.
So he said to me, go back to the book of beginnings. I knew that was Genesis.
Yes, sir.
He said, I made the world and the fullness thereof. And he said to me, the 50th Psalm said, the world and the fullness thereof is God's. It went on to say, the silver and the gold is God's. Mm-hmm. The psalmist also tells us the cattle of 1,000 hills are the Lord's. He said, now they're not mine because they're in my hands. They're mine because I created them.
Yes.
But for whom do you think I created them? The devil and his crowd?
No.
Oh.
I created all of those things before man was ever came. Now then, I got them here for him. So I made my man Adam. And I said, Adam, I give you dominion over all the work of my hands. Then he's got dominion over the cattle of 1,000 hills. He's got dominion over the silver and the gold. In one sense of the word, you could say Adam became the God of this world.
Of course.
Now, in 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter and 4th verse, the Bible said Satan's a god of this world.
Yes, sir.
How did Satan become the god of this world? Adam committed high treason.
Gave it up, yes.
Gave it over to him. And Satan's got a right to be here. And he and his cohorts will be here until Adam's lease runs out. Amen.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Well, I saw that then. I saw that. Then the Lord said to me, don't pray for finances anymore or money like you have. You know, because we begged and prayed. Slumbered and prayed.
Slumbered and prayed. Oh, no,
that's,
we've been
that's
there.
That's Oklahoma talk.
You know, that's the truth. That's the truth. Yeah. And
cried.
He said, well, I said, what do I do? He said, "You number one, you claim what you need." Now, at that time, January 1950, it took $150 a week to meet my budget. All right, then you claim that.
Okay.
And then once you claim it, say, "I claim." He said, "The money's not up here. I'm not going to send any raining down from heaven. I'd have to counterfeit, and I'm not a counterfeiter." It's down there.
Yes.
It's down there.
Yes.
So you say, and it's not me that's withholding from your children.
No.
It's Satan, the god of this world. You first claim what you need or want. And then he said, you say, "Satan, take your hand off of my money." And then you say, "Go ministering spirits and cause it to come."
Go ministering spirits.
Ministering spirits.
You're talking to the angels now.
Yeah. And I said, "Now that's brand new. That's revelation. I've never got anything like that. You know, I mean, that's different than what we've been taught."
Yes.
I said, "Lord, I'm going to have some scripture for that. I mean, he said, "Well, didn't you ever read in the book of Hebrews where it said angels are ministering spirits who are sent to minister for those who are heirs of salvation?" I said, "I thought that said minister to us." "No," he said, "it says for." I had to open my Bible and read it. Sure enough, it said minister for. He said, they're there to minister for you. Like, for instance, he said, you go into a restaurant and the waiter or waitress comes. They're not there to minister to you. They're minister for you.
Yes.
You give the order and they carry it out. Now you give the order, so go ministering spirits and cause the money to come. Never will forget it. I was in my room in the parsonage. I stayed apart. I got up and went over to the church. I'm standing on the platform trembling. And I said, "I claim $150 this week. I'm just going to be there 1 week. Satan, take your hand off of my money. Go ministering spirits and cause the money to come."
You're saying this out loud now to the church?
No, nobody there. I'm out there.
Oh, just in the church by yourself. Okay. Okay.
Went on back over the house, laid down, took me a nap. That settles it. He said, "Don't pray," so I don't pray. I said to the pastor, now we were in East Texas, and they're in the habit of taking up a pledge offering. I said, "When it comes to take up an offering, me, just pass the plate and say this is Brother Hagin's offering." Why, he said, "Brother Hagin, you won't get a quarter." I said, "Okay, I won't say a word. You just do it. Just do it." I said, "Don't make any pull." Now, I was in the same church the year before, 2 weeks. The same people are there. They got two people different. But those 2 weeks, 2 weeks, 2 weeks, the year before with the same people, in 2 weeks' time, I got $114.57. That means now that you got $57.20-some-odd a week.
Yes, yes.
Now, if you had said to them 75, they said, "Oh, man, we couldn't meet that." Or if you had said $100, "My Lord of Jesus Christ himself is here." If you said 150, they'd all fainted.
They'd have fainted. Yeah. Yeah. So what happened?
So the meeting, I said, and he said, "Well, we passed the plate Tuesday and Thursdays and Sunday night for the vandalists." I said, "Okay, just say as little as you can. This Brother Hagin's offering. Pass the plate." Well, we got to going real good, and I had another meeting come, but he said, "Could you stay on?" I stayed through Wednesday, so I changed it, made it 200. At the end of the 10 days, I've got $242 and some odd cents. Pastor, in those days, they just gave it to me.
Yes, of course.
He said, "I can't believe it."
Yeah.
Well, I just laughed to myself because I knew he wouldn't understand if I tried to explain it to him.
The difference was you spoke it, didn't you?
I've never, for me personally, prayed about finances and again. That day to the 1950.
Paul, claim the amount you need, though?
Yeah, I claim it, but I don't pray like we used to pray, you know.
Now, he came home, and he got us, we was at the breakfast table. He got us at the breakfast table, and he told us what we to do. Now, that's the way we pray. He was wherever the meeting was. That's the way the family prayed at home. Yeah. We would claim whatever it was. If he needed more, he would write mother and they wrote every day to one another all those years. Yeah. And he would write and tell her, And she said, okay, kids, this is what we believe in, for what we claim in. We'd say the same thing. He told us to say
give
that.
Let me give you a couple more testimonies.
Please.
I went down to Alabama at a meeting, little church. I drove, straight through. Got there about midnight on a Saturday. You know, no freeways.
No, less.
I sat there, Pastor wanted to preach, and I said, man, listen, I drove all day long until midnight. You go ahead and preach this morning, I'll start the revival tonight. I sat there and counted 73 people, counting me and every kid, because I got no nursery. The devil said to me, I'm sitting on the platform of the pastor, I don't know this day what he preached. He said, my boy, you played whaley. That's a good Texas expression. You know what I mean, playing whaley?
Yeah.
In other words, you've aired or missed it like Noah did and got the whaley better. You played whaley.
You played the whaley. Okay, yeah. I got you now. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Southern people understand that.
Yes, I you did. I did.
You come all the way down. You won't get enough money to get back home. Now, while he's preaching, I sat there and quietly said, I claim $150 a week. Satan, take your hand off my finances. Go ministering spirits and cause the money to come. I was there 3 weeks, never prayed another prayer or said another word. At the end of 3 weeks, I got $900 and some odd, and they bought me a new set of tires for my car.
Brother Hagin, that was a miracle, wasn't it? The pastor did faint, I bet.
Yeah,
you didn't.
That happened. I could just sit here and tell you experience after experience, till pastors would tell me, fine. If you've never taught us anything else, you've taught us how to believe God for finances. Mm-hmm. Now then, pastors would tell me, though, now you understand, though, that, well, you're an evangelist, that'll work for you. But now we pastors. So I said, Lord, I know you told me that I couldn't pastor anymore. But if you could arrange it some way or another, I want to prove this out. The Bible said prove all things. Mm-hmm. I prove everything out before I go with it. You don't just jump and run with a revelation.
Yes, sir.
Or whatever. And so I hadn't preached it. I just talked to the pastors about it, see, privately. Mm-hmm. And so a pastor there in Dallas, I held a meeting for him 7 weeks, 1953, 7 weeks revival. And then he said to me, Brother Hagin, I'm going to be gone this summer. I'm going on an evangelistic missionary tour. And would you stay and do the preaching? Now, the associate pastor will do the pastoral work. All you got to do is just do the preaching. Sunday morning, Sunday night, Tuesday night, Friday night. And then he had a daily radio program. Well, I said, I prayed about it. And the Lord said, do it. Here's your opportunity to prove what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. Now, he was gone really 3.5 months. The last Sunday of he was there, the end of May, he was encouraging people to be faithful. I just sat there on the platform very quietly, said, because now his radio program was $3,750. Don't sound like a lot of money now, but we're talking about, 45 years ago.
Yes, sir.
$3,750 in the red. They were going to put him off. He has to pay so much each week. Mm-hmm. Or else he's gone. The church said, well, it was really just his broadcast, I mean, as a pastor. Mm-hmm. The deacon board said, well, it helps the church. And so Tuesday night is radio night, often goes to. During my revival for 7 weeks, they never took under 45 minutes and usually an hour and a half raising money. Because they're going off, on. Mm-hmm. They'd come on saying that, got to hear from you. See. So I sat there on the platform and said quietly to the Lord, I claim every need met, radio, every need the church. I didn't know what figure to give. But, and when end of summer, the pastor comes back, we'll be in the black, not in the red, in every area. And Satan, take your hand off our money. Go minister spirits, cause the money to come. And I was there 3 months and never prayed another prayer about it. Other, when you take up an offering, you pray a prayer. You know what I mean?
Of course.
Now then, he left. The assistant or associate pastor, he's still on the radio. But the first Tuesday night, I didn't get to him. So he spent 45 minutes raising. We don't want to lose his program. So I said to him, don't do that anymore. Mm-hmm. Well, Brother Hagin, they'll lose that program. We have to. I said, no. And I said, on the radio, don't say we're going off. You talk about the lack of money that keeps it from coming in. And I said, I said, okay, I'll just pay it myself. Well, I couldn't pay it myself. He knew that, so. But anyway, I told him, I said, okay. And so they had a person that they called him radio minister because he answered the mail. He told me, he said, right in the summertime, which it usually never does, said it doubled. At the end of the summer, we got his radio program paid out of the black, out of the red and into black. We had a meeting with all the board members and Secretary of Treasury, and he gave the report, and we had 8 cents over.
8 cents over.
8 cents.
I see.
Well, the pastor said to me, Brother Hagin, you don't understand. You can ask any of these board. We always go in the red every summer. We have an emergency fund. This is the first time in 8 years that I've been here. 8 years. Well, I said, all I claimed was we'd go, we're in the black. We're in the black. I proved it worked in the church.
Oh, wow. Hallelujah.
Paul, these same principles, Rhema Bible Church, I used these same principles, paid off $12 million in 6 years. From February 92.
Besides operating
expenses. Besides operating expenses, support and missions and everything else. From February of 92 to July of 98, the Rhema Bible Church paid us, going to pay off $12 million, these same principles.
Out of debt.
Praise you, Jesus.
Till I was in eighth grade, I had How Bed Will Roll, wherever I could roll it and put it out. But after then, I had a bedroom. Thank God we learned those principles.
Dear friends, let me tell you, if you have enjoyed this tremendous teaching that we have had from the Word of God tonight, tune in every Sunday morning at 7 o'clock California time, 8 o'clock Phoenix, 9 o'clock Tulsa, 10 o'clock Miami, and you will hear some of this good teaching and preaching coming from Rhema in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Brother Hagin, I promised I'd get you out of here by 8:30. It's 8:28. And now you do pray for the sick.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But
oh, yeah.
As you lead us in prayer for these many people who are hurting and need a physical touch, do you want to give them a final little word of it? They ought to be saying something as we're praying,
oh, yes,
shouldn't
yes,
they?
Yes, yes, yes.
Tell them what to do as we're praying.
Well, you just say, I believe I receive.
I believe
That's
I receive.
Said. When you pray, believe you receive.
Yes.
I believe I receive my healing. Praise God. Father, we lay hands upon these right now, claiming the healing of each and every one of these. It's written on these pieces of paper.
Jesus.
We thank you, dear Father, because healing belongs to us now.
That we receive.
And you said when you pray, believe that you receive and ye shall have. We believe we receive. And everyone who hears us just now repeats with their mouth, I believe I receive
my
healing. Now begin to thank him for it.
Hallelujah.
Begin to praise him for it.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Amen. It is said concerning Paul and Silas in jail in Philippi at midnight, they prayed and sang praises to God.
Yes.
The answer came while they were singing praises.
Yes,
so begin to praise him for your healing.
Amen. 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 And all the church said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Let's tell Brothers Hagin we love them very much and appreciate them being here tonight and for sending us a new program every week.
Oh, yeah. Amen. We're excited about it. We're excited.
Praise God. And don't be so long coming back.
All right. I'm busy.
You've got your little I know, but hey, you may have talked to more people tonight than you did in your whole ministry.
By the way, our director of all of our television used to be with you here at TBN, Greg Stevens.
I know. I met Greg. He was here tonight, and you've got a fine young man to help you and work with you. Well,
God
bless you. Vern Jackson sings another great song that will bless both of you tonight as we change the order here a little bit. We've got another wonderful one of your disciples is here tonight.
Brother Thompson,
Brother Leroy Thompson Sr., Word of Life Christian Center from Darrow, Louisiana, is here tonight. And he has written a book. I guess the Lord wants us to talk a little bit about money tonight.
Amen.
He's written a book entitled Money Cometh to the Body of Christ.
Amen.
Hey, we'll get into that in just a little bit. But let's tell Brother Hagin and Brother Hagin one more time. We do love them. We honor them.
Thank you
for coming and blessing us tonight and teaching us the precious word of the Lord.
We have our own plane now, so we'll try to get back more.
Please.
Please do.
Makes it much easier.
Please do. Please do.
If you lose a couple of days, you know, coming or going to 3 days.
Oh, I know. Thank you.
Besides, we can make it a little easier on you now. Jan,
go to Dallas
we've got
Nashville.
A nice place in Dallas and in Nashville and a little closer to Tulsa.
Yeah.
And if we'd had time, I'd have loved to told the story of the time you came to Oklahoma City and you stepped out of the car into the red mud about that deep and it went up to your cowboy boots and we was... That was a funny, funny story.
He was cleaning his own boots.
We helped Dad clean up his boots, and we got him on. And before the program was over, his feet and boots looked like red brick.
There's mud all up and down.
He didn't have on no boots. That's, he never wore boots.
That's for another boots. Night. We'll reminisce a little bit when you come again sometime. Vern Jackson sings a great song, Long Winding Road. We're on that old road right now, and we dedicate this to Brother Hagin as well.
When I made my start for heaven, I could only find one way. The road that led me through the mountains, through the valleys, the road that many folks could take. Since I started on my journey, I've covered many, many, many miles behind me. Miles of sun and rain, miles of smiles and pain. The road's been rough, but I again would choose the same. Up ahead I see a sign that points me straight ahead to my victory. I know I must be traveling right. I remember passing Calvary. And although it's dusty and the road is old, and for years it's bore the traveler's load, someday this road will turn to gold. There are some times when the rocks hurt my feet, my old body burns from the sweat and the heat. My strength is drained till my whole face marks the pain. My back is bent from the strain. I know I could turn around, for the old road, it's still there. But every mountain that I've climbed, I again would have to bear. You see, I really can't turn back. Someone may be using my tracks. I see one bend that just might be this road's end. Keep on meeting me. Up ahead I see a sign that points me straight ahead to my victory. I know I must be traveling right. I remember passing Calvary. And although it's dusty and the road is old, and for years It's for the traveler's load. Someday this road will turn to gold. And for some this road's already turned to gold. And for me, someday this road will turn to gold.
I do love that song. I know many of you want to get in touch with Vern Jackson. Let's get an address up there quickly. Those of you that Vern has moved, he is now up in Long Beach,
My
California.
Goodness.
So some of you will want to jot a new little address down to Vern if you want in touch with him about his ministry, his music, his travel, his itinerary. There it is, 800 East Ocean Boulevard, Suite 703, Long Beach, California. 90802. Hey, he's even on the internet, for heaven's sake. Boy, we're coming up in the world here, Vern Jackson.
Really?
Let's say hello to a wonderful new brother, at least to me. He is a disciple, I would say, of Brother Kenneth Hagin, Sr.
Son.
A son.
A son of, a spiritual son.
Yeah.
That's a better way of putting it.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Leroy Thompson, Sr. He is a teacher, author, pastor, founder of Word of Life Christian Center. Baptized in the Holy Spirit in 1984, teaches how to live the life of faith, how to walk by faith and not by sight, how to keep the devil under your feet and live the victorious, abundant life in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Boy, we just about preached a little message
Hallelujah.
There right on the introduction
Hallelujah.
Here.
Hallelujah.
He's written a couple of books, too, entitled Money Cometh to the Body of Christ. Hey, that just gets right down on it. And also, another book entitled How to Speak the Word of God with the Voice
of Jesus.
Of Jesus.
Wow.
Let's tell Brother Leroy Thompson, welcome to
Thank
Praise the Lord tonight.
Thank
how are you, sir?
Fine, sir. How are you?
God bless you.
Nice to meet
you. Oh, we've got such a little bit. You're going to have to come back, brother. Let's just get right down to it. Give me this book quick. Money Cometh. Now, boy, the heretic hunters are going to be all over you just like they are on me now. They say all you TV preachers do is talk about money, 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 money. But you know what? If God's people don't get a hold of the finances of this world, who's going to finance the end-time harvest and get the souls in?
That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. Money Cometh is a revelation God gave me about 5 years ago. The revelation of money cometh is that it's a continuous process of money coming to the body of Christ that the harvest may be reaped. We need finances to reap the harvest. Money cometh, when God gave me those words are prophetical. This is on the fifth printing. Millions of dollars have come into the body of Christ because of those words. It makes a demand on money. It's something about saying it three times. Paul, I don't know what it is. Money cometh. You say it three times, and then there are the principles that goes along with this. There's three major principles that will activate that revelation in your life. And the first principle is always keep God first.
Okay.
Always keep God first.
In your giving, though.
In your giving, seed time and harvest. Well, let's back up a little bit. Seed time and harvest is the kingdom of God mode of operation.
Yes, sir.
I believe this word gives the body of Christ a voice in the financial arena. Because what they've done for me personally, what they've done for my ministry, I have a lot of spiritual sons, what they've done in their ministry. Some of their ministry have tripled in finances because they got the revelation of this book and the revelation of money coming.
Okay. I'll play the part. I need money.
Okay. Okay.
My heart's right. I love God. I want to be a giver into His kingdom. I want to win souls. First of all, your motive's got to be right, doesn't it?
Correct.
I mean, you can't just say I want money because I want a Rolls Royce.
No, you can't. You can't have the wrong relationship with material things. Erroneous concept have been given to the body of Christ about money, that we shouldn't have money, that the less money you have, the more closer you can be to God. Mm-hmm. But that book tells you, and it's a revelation from the Word of God, poverty is not the will of God. A person who wants to give into the kingdom of God, there is no exit out of a need without a seed.
Whoa, whoa. Wow. Wait, say that one more time.
There is no exit out of a need without a seed.
That's a good word.
You've got to have a seed because the whole law, Genesis 8:22, the whole kingdom of God, God's ways of doing things, Paul, is by seed time and harvest.
That's right.
So when you have a need, find your seed. Your motive has to be right. You have to have the right relationship with material thing. You have to keep God in first place. You have to know that God owns everything and I own nothing. I'm only a steward. You have the third principle is God first, others second, I'm last.
Okay.
And then the last principle that I teach in this book is God is my source. Now, that's a lesson within itself because to qualify to be a sower, you have to begin to sow for a living.
Okay.
Many people think their job is their source, but you'll never find a job pay you enough to live like God wants you to live. You'll never find a job to have enough money to support the type of vision. Look at this vision here.
Yes, sir.
The vision you have, the type of money you need, just from a secular point of view, this will never exist. We need miracles. We need the supernatural abundance. We need good measure pressed down, shaken together for this type of ministry.
We need hundredfold.
We need millions of dollars, billions of dollars.
Yes.
So therefore, when the body of Christ recognize who they are, that God has given us the power to get wealth. Now, notice why he gave us the power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant.
Yes.
So his covenant is the revelation. Men and women of God, like you and Jan, who have got such a vast revelation, we in the body of Christ got to tap into the Word of God, tap into the anointing of prosperity, and yield ourselves and begin to plant seed and expect God to give us a harvest. And then we'll be able to give tithes. We'll be able to support ministries like yours. You can't support this ministry. I mean, you can give. We give small portion. We don't make little small portion because these people got to come up. But you need a lot of money to do this. In this book, it'll tell you how.
Okay.
It'll tell you how.
What's, if a person is financially in need, okay, what would Fred, or what would Leroy Thompson do first?
Find a seed.
Okay.
Find a seed, then find soil.
Good soil.
That is productive.
Ah.
And that is productive. You got to find soil. Now, you just can't plant everywhere. You got to find soil. In other words, you get the seed, you seek God's face, and God tell you where to plant a seed. And then you water the seed by a good confession, by keeping the right motive, keeping your mouth right, mm-hmm. walking in love, as we've heard.
Yes, sir.
And God will cause that seed to multiply.
So it starts simply by giving, doesn't it?
Started all by giving. There's no such thing. I know somebody was asking about money coming, and they thought they had never heard me teach on this subject. And they thought I was just saying money coming. But there's a lot of principles here mm-hmm. to tell you how to survive until the money arrives. It tells you about that we are delivered from the curse. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. Poverty is a curse. Yes. And we've had so much religion, tradition, denomination, doctrines of men, theology, have taught us poverty. But actually, the covenant, we have a covenant of wealth. Actually, that scripture where Jesus died, became poor, we might become rich. Mm-hmm. Jesus, for a moment, there exchanged place with us. Mm-hmm. He took our sin and he did take our poverty for a moment there when he died in our place.
Yes, he did.
Only for a moment, because on the third day he got up and got back in his place, but he had us in his place. Mm-hmm. Now, it worked by seed time and harvest. It works by confession. It works by walking in love. So all those things have to mingle together in order to cause money to come to you. Now, actually, Brother Hagin was talking about clamming the money and sending the ministering spirit to harvest it.
Yes, sir.
Money cometh, they are harvesting words. They have, money cometh is making a demand on money. Money, just like the fig tree, obeyed Jesus. If you got seed time and harvest in play, you in the right soil, planting a ministry like this, in the right soil, money has to obey you just like that fig tree. And what happened is, and I've seen it over and over and over again.
What's the difference between the fig tree and money? Money, I mean, we have dominion, but we've been erroneously taught about money. So many Christian believers are suffering, living from paycheck to paycheck. That is not God's will. It is not God's will for none of his children to live in lack. They just have to get somewhere where they can be taught the word of God, come out of debt, Paul. Mm-hmm. Come out of debt that when God said, I got a job I want done, I need 20 people to give $30,000, put yourself in a position and say, hey, I'm one of those persons. I'll give the first $1,000, $30,000.
Yes, sir.
But so many in the body of Christ now are broke. They are broke because they didn't have not got the revelation that God is a God of prosperity. I know there's a lot of things that come up, and a lot of people say, preacher taking the money, and and then they have the fear, if I give, that God's word is not going to do what it said it's going to do. I'll tell you right now, God's word will do exactly what it said it will do. I can tell you from preaching. I can tell you from experience. I can tell you from my own personal life. I can tell you from my own ministry. I can tell you from hundreds of other people's lives that if you get a hold of the revelation and do what the revelation tells you to do, money will run you down. You can become a money magnet if you keep your priorities straight. Yes, what's the purpose of the money? God wants his children to have money that this gospel may preach all over the world.
Yes, sir.
For one, that's priority. Secondly, that we might destroy the works of the devil.
Yes, you,
we cannot destroy the works of the devil in this earth's realm without money. We got to have places like this. We got to have television ministry. We got to have radio ministry. We got to have transportation to go to the different part of the world and preach the gospel.
Got to have Rhema Bible
We
colleges.
Got to have Rhema Bible colleges. We got to support them. And,
yes.
And I'm a great supporter of it, Paul. I know part of my success is latching on to Dad. God told me that he's my spiritual father. And I've been supporting that ministry for over 10 years now. And I'm telling you the fruit. Mm-hmm. I think this revelation came to me because I've been a submissive son. Just a little side journey. I believe every man, every minister should find their spiritual father.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I think every minister should find their spiritual father. So we are aiming by direction of the Holy Spirit to get this material in the body of Christ's hand. We're preaching across the country as fast as we can, this message.
So you're not pastoring right now, then?
I'm pastoring, Paul. I have a jet. I go in and out. I go in and out. I have my own. I have a citation, too. And so I fly.
So you can still pastor and still...
I preach on Sunday morning, fly out Sunday evening, preach Sunday night, Monday and Tuesday at a church, fly back Wednesday, feed my people and minister, and then I fly out again if I have to go somewhere. So I'm traveling all over the United States preaching the message. As I said, this book is in its fifth printing. It's very simple, nothing deep. Any person who want to get out of debt and get in a position where they can support ministries like this and ministers that are doing the kingdom of God work, that book will bring them to revelation.
Getting the curse of poverty off the body of Christ. These are some of the chapters.
Yes.
What causes money not to come? Mm-hmm. Ooh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Right and wrong thinking about money. Mm-hmm. Seed power and increase. Yield what you have to God, and He will multiply it. How to survive until prosperity arrives. That's got to be a good chapter, too. Oh, Lord, we could spend the next 3 hours, but they ought to just get the book, I guess.
Get the hand on it.
Give us an address, and those of you that want information about Brother Leroy Thompson and his great work and ministry, his church down in Daro, do you know where Daro, Louisiana is?
No.
My little southern belle?
No. Sandwiched between New Orleans and Baton Rouge, about 20 miles out of Baton Rouge, 60 miles out of New
Orleans.
Now
we know about where you are.
Okay, how many people do you have in your church?
I have 1,647 people. I'm in a town of, the population of the town, I mean, is 300.
You've got four times the population of the town.
You can drive 100-mile radius east, west, north, and south.
Bless your sweet heart. Yeah. My goodness.
That's nice.
We just built a new church, Paul, paid for it cash.
Wow.
Working those principles.
Interesting. Also, you've got to come back so we can get into the other book, How to Speak the Word of God with the Voice of Jesus.
Wow.
You know, this word that you've been teaching us came, you know R.W. Shambaugh, don't you?
Yes, sir. Definitely so.
Well, last November, twice a year we have a little week where we just tell the people we got to have money to keep these lights on and keep this. We don't beg, we don't plead, we don't anything, you know. Yeah. And God sends in. The Lord gave Brother Shambach a rhema word, and actually that word is continuing right on through this month of April. And God spoke a word. He said, if people will move in faith and make, and he said, don't ask me why, but the word of the Lord was a $2,000 pledge. And he said, I know I'm talking to a lot of people that don't have it. You don't know where you're going to get it. You don't know how God would get it to you. You've never had $2,000 to give. It's scaring you half to death to think about right. even pledging it.
Right.
But he said, do it. Do it. Obey God. And Brother Johnson, Thompson, I'm here to tell you that the windows of heaven opened, because that was a rhema word from the Lord, and thousands of people moved in faith. And then the word of the Lord came and said, if you'll move in faith and if you'll make that pledge, the Lord spoke to Brother Shambach that within 90 days he would put that seed in their hand so that they would be able to give it. And he said he asked the Lord a little later, why 90 days? And he said he did a little research, and it takes a seed just about
That's
90
right.
days to germinate
before it can be aborted
and begin to grow and sprout. And even tonight, dear friends, if you missed out, we're going to have another great debt-burning, altar service. We had one in Italy the other night, sweetheart. It was wonderful. It was just glorious. And we've got prayer partners on the line right now. Lines are open. If you didn't get in on it, you can make that pledge tonight in Jesus' name.
And this is for people that don't even have seed.
Yeah.
Because the Word says in 2 Corinthians, for God, who gives the seed to the farmer to plant and later on good crops to harvest and eat, will give you more and more seed
yes.
to plant and will make it grow, that you can give away more and more fruit from your own harvest. You know, the Lord spoke to me before this telethon that this telethon wasn't for TBN at all. It wasn't for TBN at all. It was for the little partners out there, that God was going to give individual telethons to each little partner that just obeyed His word.
Amen.
And it was their praise-a-thon telethon.
So, Paul, would you permit me to release this anointing?
Yes.
Please.
I believe, my wife and I believe this is good soil, so we're going to leave our tooth out. Because this is good soil here.
That's
and
your
I want
sweetheart.
To talk to them on the television screen. I go along with Brother Shambach,
right there.
And in the name of Jesus, there's anointing upon me to prosper. And in the name of Jesus, I'm going to believe God that you're going to get your seed and that there's going to be an extra influx of you giving, because God touched you tonight about money cometh unto you now in the name of
Amen.
Jesus.
We agree.
Now, Father, I thank you for every person listening to this broadcast in Jesus' name. Move them into financial blessing tonight in the name of Jesus. Let an anointing of prosperity come upon every person that is listening to this broadcast, and they'll find their $2,000, they'll send it, and you will multiply in Jesus' name. We believe it's so.
Amen. 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 And that will begin the journey out of debt.
Hallelujah.
For the body of Jesus Christ. And I have thousands of testimonies from people just like you. Some of you are watching tonight and you're saying amen. I can feel you in the spirit. And it worked for me.
I know.
I did this and an unexpected blessing has come to me that overwhelmed me. I have received that hundredfold blessing in return from a totally unexpected source. Oh, it's wonderful. It works, dear friends. Do it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You know, I don't have time now to show you, but I'll do it tomorrow night when Benny Hinn comes. Mm-hmm. The great crusade that Benny just concluded in London, England. I was there and I got to say a little word on your behalf. And we've got some exciting news about Europe and London. Then we went down to Italy and helped Chuck and Nora Hall with the first night of their little praise-a-thon down there. Italy is going to be self-supporting, honey, just in no time. Northern Italy already is, but now we got to help Rome a little bit.
Out of debt.
So tomorrow night, don't you dare not be with us tomorrow night. Our precious brother Benny Hinn will be here,
right here
tomorrow night, right here in the studio, here in Studio C, and we'll have a wonderful time. Brother Leroy Thompson, God bless you, sir. Thank you. Put Brother Thompson's address up. Many of you will want to get in touch with him. Word of Life Christian Center, Box 7, Darrow, Louisiana, 70725. If you want information on Brother Thompson's wonderful ministry and these great books that he has written. Let's say goodnight in song, and we'll be also agreeing and praying for your needs again, in addition to what Brother Hagin has just done.
This program has been brought to you through the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout North America and the world.